Continue the excerpts from the songs of Nanak. Ek Omkar Satnam, the heartbeat of Nanak. After emerging from the river, Ek Omkar Satnam is the message of Nanak. That which is one, Omkar Swarup, the exist, the very nature of that which is uncreated, existential sound, Omkar. Nobody is creating, yet still the sound exists. Then the attributes, what is the nature of that which is one, that which is uncreated. Now it comes, Adi Sach, Jugadi Sach, Havi Sach, Nanak Hosiri Sach. This is the slok. What does it mean? What is the nature? How can you know that this particular message is true or untrue? Difference between true and untrue. That is what is explained in these two lines, which is known as slok in Japji Sahib or Gurvani. The first that I had spoken earlier is the Mool Mantra. This is slok. Adi Sach, Jugadi Sach, Habi Sach, Nanak Hosi Bhi Sach. Adi means beginning. Sach means true. Jugadi means dissolution, the end. Sach again means truth. That which is true in the beginning and true in the dissolution. And then in between beginning and dissolution, this is nowness. It is true now. You can only be transformed if you experience this now and here. True before creation, true through all the ages, true also today, says Nanak. True he shall eternally be beyond time and space. This is the realm of meditation. True before creation, true all through the ages, true also today, says Nanak. True he shall eternally be beyond time and space. Normally mind swings between past and the future and skips the present. Even if it talks about the present, it is a span of time away. When you look at the present tense in the grammar, it is not what present actually means existentially. Present means that which cannot be captured in time and space. The moment you say now, can you encompass it between time and space? No. It is a very dynamic, precise moment, and by the time you have said now, now is disappeared. Now is no more. It is a very precise, dynamic moment, beyond time and space. This is why it is not the ordinary word, not the ordinary message. Instead, it is the meditativeness. It is the energy field of Nanak. People are trying to understand the words of Nanak through their understanding. You can find the Sikhs very easily, but not the fragrance of Nanak. You can find Christians, but not the aura of Jesus. You can find Buddhists, but not the inner awakening of Buddha. You can find Muslims, but not the Noor of Muhammad, the light of Muhammad. So many religious people are available dime a dozen. You will not find even a single person whose very presence wraps the fragrance and aura of a Buddha, of a Lao Tse, a Muhammad, a Nanak, a Kabir, or a Jesus. Crowds converge, clamoring around temples, gurdwaras, churches, and mosques like slaves. Slaves of the dead past in a hackneyed way. Indeed, a master frees you from the past. This is what Nanak has done. This is what the message of Nanak is contained in these paulis of Japji Sahib, the sutras of Japji Sahib. There were traditions, people were holding on to the dead traditions, like the Nath tradition, many other things that people were holding on. The inner fabric was losing its fragrance at the time that Nanak appeared. He resurrected, gave a new fragrance. After Nanak is no more, the same traditions are being continued in another form. Indeed, a master frees you from the past and the religions. A master frees you from the past. This is a spirituality. And the religions, your so-called old outer religions and sects, they keep you yoked to the traditions. Thus, through his awareness, the master goes on deleting your memory and conditionings until the inner sky is clear. But the religions keep on adding more and more to your memory until a time comes when your memory crashes. Only when your inner sky is clear, then truth can manifest in its sublime essence. A master does not give you anything to learn because he has no knowledge. Religion is full of knowledge. Religion is knowledgeable. Religion is knowing your traditions, your values. Master is awareness, and that is his light or bliss. Instead, he initiates the process of unlearning. He says, unlearn whatever you have learned so far. Drop it as dust. Clean your mirror completely of all dust. This process is known as initiation or bath or amrit chakna in the way of the Gurdwara or the Sikh tradition. When the inner mirror, the inner screen is clear, God is reflected naturally and spontaneously. When Nanak said Ek Omkar Satnam, it was a complete discontinuity with the past. This is the way of Nanak. This is the way of Japji Sahib, but not the way of the tradition. Tradition always holds on to the past. Thereafter comes the first sutra or Pauli as it is known as. Sochai soch na hovai je soch lakwar, means by thinking you cannot attain to it. You may think 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, but you will not understand. Chupai chup na hovai lai raha limtar. Then immediately the question comes, if by thinking I cannot attain, then let me be silent. Maybe by being silent I can understand it. Again Nanak emphasizes and makes it clear, by being silent you cannot attain. You can stop talking, but that does not mean the inner clatter has vanished. Outwardly you have become silent, but inwardly the clatter continues. Bhukhiya bhuk na utri je banna puriya bhar, sahasya anpa lakhoi ta ikna chale naal. Nanak asks the question, kib sachyara hoye, when will truth dawn? Kib kule to tepal, when will the veil of ignorance, the veil of illusion, the veil of nafs, the veil of ego vanish? And he answers, hukum rajai charana Nanak likhya naal. Flow with the existential law. Hukum means that everything is happening in its own way. Nobody does anything, yet still everything is happening. But man is doer, continues to think that by doing he can attain to this or that. Nothing. You cannot attain to anything by your doing. Your doing is important. Your doing takes you to the point where you are completely exhausted. And that very moment, when you are exhausted, something dawns in you. You start paddling your bicycle. A moment comes when bicycle gains momentum. Then you do not have to do anything. Just keep your feet on the pedal and the bicycle moves on its own. Your vehicle in the beginning, you have to continue to accelerate, and yet still the speed is not coming. Then with the continuous effort of acceleration, a moment comes, then the vehicle comes in a momentum, and then the speed is maintained. You do not have to continue to accelerate. You just maintain, keep the pedal steady. vehicle continues at a certain speed, so too it happens. When you flow with this, when you understand this, the cosmic law that binds everything, the seasons, the summer, the winter, the rain, who is there to plant them? Every morning at a certain time, birds begin to chirp. The first sound begins, then after a little pause, it comes like a clarion call. The first bird will make the sound, then this is heard by the others. All of a sudden there is a sound of chirping, and it is a clarion call. Everything is happening, and the birds do not know the time, they do not have the clock. If you have to get up 4 o'clock, you have to set your alarm, and still you may not wake up. Is it natural? When it comes natural, there is something inner within you that will wake you at a certain time. Once you decide, and once you are open to that innerness, no one will have to wake you up. No one will have to set the alarm. All of a sudden, when this rhythm is gained into you, you will realize that you wake up at a certain time every day. The more precise you are, the more your inner sky is clear, you will realize that you are becoming more and more existential and less unnatural, less and less conditioned. A bird is not conditioned. The seasons are not conditioned. How does the leaves know that time has come to turn gold? And even when it is decaying, it turns yellow, it turns red, and it gives a beautiful spectrum of colors. When you are having a little trouble, your all the beauty disappears, and there is tremendous ugliness on your face and all around. You cannot smile. But you look at the leaf that was green. It is now going to decay. Yet still it maintains its luscious hue and fills the atmosphere, fills the existence with its colors. In autumn, when the leaves are ready to die, ready to decay, there is a beautiful golden reddish color all around the trees, and that glows in the setting of the sun or the rising of the sun as it appears on the horizon. Nanak emphasizes on this existential law. This is the essence. Thinking leads not belief. Even if one thinks a million times, prolonged silence and meditation does not quieten the mind. Hunger cannot be satiated even with all the food and the wealth. At the time of death, intellectual smartness also stays behind. How can then we realize the truth and destroy all that is false? Nanak says, live with his divine will. Be within the existential law. A new meaning will arise. Nanak calls this as hukum. Hukum rajai chalna Nanak likhiya naal. Flow with the existential law. Life will attain a new meaning. He is the only truth. He is true in the beginning. Now Nanak has personified the truth. This is the way of explanation. This does not mean truth is a person sitting somewhere. In order to speak to you, in order for you to understand, a form is necessary. But truth has no form. Yet still if you try to understand, it has a form. Nanak says he is the only truth. He is true in the beginning. He is true in the end. He is truth now. He will be truth forever. His truth is beyond time and space. So what is the nature of truth? Is meditativeness. Nowness. Now and here. Beyond time and space. All that is beyond time and space is now. It is beyond mind. It is the realm of meditativeness. It is the realm of innerness. For this you have to move from the realm of the mind to another realm. And that another realm is beyond mind. Of this you know not, neither by thinking can you attain. Also by your constant thinking you have missed the essence. Inner chattering continues unabated, and there seems to be no way to cease this chattering. How and when will the veil of ignorance or illusion will vanish? And when will truth manifest? The methodology comes. Hukum rajai chalana Nanak likhyana. Nanak says, flow with the existential law. Be natural. Be spontaneous. You have fallen in tune with the existence. What is the definition of truth and non-truth? What does a master like Nanak understand by truth? How to make you understand this? May be a problem with you. It is bound to be. However, such is not the case with Nanak. Having drunk the life's elixir, words are simply flowing effortlessly out of Nanak. It seems as if words are coming not from the mind. Although mind mechanism is working to continue the message, but the words are forming from the deepest core of Nanak's being, the infinite, unfathomable realm of harmony and oneness. These words of Japaji Sahib have emerged from the infinite, the unfathomable realm of harmony to which Nanak has reached, to which Nanak has attained, to which Nanak has experienced this oneness. Adi Sach, Jugadi Sach, Habi Sach, Nanak Hosi Bhi Sach. He is the only truth. He is true in the beginning. He is true in the end. He is truth now. He will be truth forever. His truth is beyond time and space. Such is the only definition of truth. You take the milk, it is true now. It remains, it curdles, truth is gone. All that is form decays with the passage of time. That which is now but not later is sentient. That which is now but not later is transient. That cannot be caught. God is eternity. This is the definition of truth and untruth. Untruth is that which is ephemeral, short-lived, something that goes on changing. Untruth is that ceases to exist at two shores. Look at the dream. Before you went to sleep, it was not. And when you wake up again, it is not. A dream exists only between these two shores of waking and dreaming state of awareness. And these states are not permanent, not in your control. Either until you are totally awake, and when you are totally awake, and when you are awake totally, then you will remain awake even in your sleep and dreaming states as well. Then dreams are no more, and thus disappears the veil, all that beclouds the manifestation of truth. The truth is beclouding its manifestation. It is the unconsciousness, it is your dreaming state, it is your sleepness. The veil of ignorance continues as long as you are unconscious. And when you are totally awake, then you will remain awake even in your sleep and dreaming state as well. You know that you are dreaming, but you are awake, that it is a dream. You go into your fancy, but you do not know that this is fancy. You go to a movie, you watch things going on the screen, you are lost into it. You think it to be reality. But you think it to be reality because you are unconscious. You have not experienced truth. All that is happening on the screen of the television, it's simply, what is the reason? Why is this movie showing on the television screen? Simply for the purpose of entertainment. But we get lost into its emotions, into its storyline, into its tagline. And thus we move far away from reality. But the moment you are awake totally, then you will remain awake even in your dreams and your sleep as well. Then dreams are no more. And thus will disappear the veil, All that beclouds the manifestation of truth. The veil of ignorance and illusion as well. The dreams are when you are dreaming. In the morning when you wake up, the dream disappears. On waking, you know dream cannot be true. It was not there in the evening, and again it is not there in the morning. These are the two shows. One day your body was no more, and one day again it will be no more. Your body is false. Between these two shows of birth and death, it exists. Truth is that which exists beyond time and space. Body exists within time and space. All that is untrue continues to live between the two shows, between the time and space. Truth is that which exists beyond time and space. This is the definition of Nanak and all other mystics. One moment there is anger, and next moment anger is gone. It is dreamlike. Nanak says, when you allow this understanding to sink in you, you will be transformed. That anger is now. It was not there before, and it will not be afterwards. This is dreamlike. But we remain engrossed in all that is dreamlike. The anger is there this moment, but it continues to linger, and it shapes of all your dealings with the person. Today you are angry with your spouse for some reason or the other. That situation is gone, but the anger remains, and this anger continues to shape up your life, your dealings with that person. You can never have the same communion that you had before this particular incident happened. This is dreamlike. One moment there is anger, and next moment it is no more. This is dreamlike. Nanak says, when you allow this understanding to sink in you, you will be transformed. Do not be too much concerned with mind and its mechanism of veiling truth. Mind continues to veil the truth. Mind says that this person has cheated you once. He can cheat you again. This becomes a pattern. This will continue to shape up your future relations, future dealings with that person. Nanak says, do not be too much concerned with the mind and its mechanism. Why? Because it continues to veil the truth. The things may have changed, the person may have transformed, but the mind will never see that change. Because the pattern, the conditioning, the way the mind is conditioned, it will fail to recognize, fail to see the transformation in the person. That which is beyond change. What is that within that never changes? Seek that alone, says an ecstatic Nanak. Certainly that lies within you, veiled by your vision and cognition, and all changes happen around that eternal alone. Try to understand this. A wheel moves. How does it happen? The wheel is visible. Its movement is visible. But the wheel moves around an axle. The axle remains fixed, unmoved. You move the axle, you remove the axle, the wheel falls immediately. Without the axle, the wheel cannot move, cannot revolve. The change in the movement of the wheel happens around the fixed axle. So too, the axle of soul, the spirit, the consciousness, the light, the awakening remains ever fixed, and body revolves around this axle of soul. Nanak echoes incessantly, that which is true in the beginning, true in the dissolution, it is true now. Its nature is that it is true beyond time and space. That alone is true. How can that alone be true? Because nothing else exists except that eternal. The wheel is moving now, then it pauses. The movement was necessary to cover a distance, but the axle always remains. The movement of the wheel disappeared, and one day when the wheel is not needed anymore, it will not be there. This veils the manifestation that alone is true. How can that alone be true? Because nothing else exists except that eternal and immutable. All the rest is dreamlike. And that which is dreamlike veils the manifestation of truth. Now the methodology. When anger plagues your consciousness, hate inflicts you, allow the words of Nanak to echo in you like the dissolving notes of an enchanting melody or an intoxicating awareness. Remember Adisat, that which is true in the beginning, that is, that which is true in the dissolution, is true now and will always be true beyond time and space. Be a witness. The moment you echo these words, witnessing dawns in you. That which is true in the beginning. Anger was not true in the beginning. And anger will not be there after a little while. But its dreamlike state has shaped your life, shaped your pattern, shaped your dealings with that person. Your dream, your so horrible, fearful dream, the dream that was not there before, the dream is not there anymore, but the effect of this dream continues to linger on in your memory. You come home, you are driving, you lock all your windows, you lock all your doors. You come home, as soon as you open the door, you watch here and there all around, and you enter the house and lock it up again. Shapes of your life. Nanak says you cannot attain to this awareness or witnessing by thinking. And through thinking alone, you have lost your serenity. Because you had been thinking of the fear, you had been thinking of what your spouse has done to you. And in doing that, you have lost your awareness. Your spouse may have done to you once or twice or thrice. After that, there may have been a transformation. But you continue to think that this is what happened and you will do this again. And through thinking alone, you have lost your serenity. Nanak says, God is not a conclusion of anything, any hypothesis. God is not a conclusion of any hypothesis. This is hypothesis, that this person has done this to you once, will do it again, and you continue to live in that. This is a hypothesis. And when there is a hypothesis, it veils the manifestation of truth. And it creates a pattern of illusion around you, and you will not be able to see any change taking place. Also, he is not the conclusion of any logic. When you are continuously thinking, there is a logic, and then all the decision comes out of that conclusion of that logic. God is eternal truth. The way is not through thinking. What will you gain through thinking? By thinking alone, you have lost. Through thinking, you are lost in the forest of woods and duality. You have to attain eyes to see the essential. When your eyes are full of thoughts, full of conditionings, you will remain blind. Your eyes need to be nirvichar, or attain to the state of thoughtlessness. Nirvichar means thoughtlessness. A state beyond thoughts, beyond conditionings. Zen calls this as no mind. Kabir calls this as unmuni dasha, or a state of awareness. A state when you are neither awake nor asleep. You have decided to go to sleep. You put your head on the pillow. You are waking. Then a state comes when you are not neither waking nor sleeping. That is a precise moment. And then all of a sudden, you fall into sleep. Patanjali calls this as nirvikar samadhi. Nir means without. Vikar means conditionings, the patterns. Vikar actually means, you can say that all that is, that veils the manifestation of truth. Dust. Dust of thoughts. Dust of conditioning. Dust of logic. And nirvikar means that which is free from all conditionings. All these are different ways to explain the same state of awareness. This refers to a state when all thoughts, opportunities and alternatives are no more. Neither by thinking nor by a forceful silence can you attain this. By thinking, inner silence is not attained. Thinking is an effort. You cannot fall asleep through effort. All efforts have to drop, and then suddenly you realize that you have fallen asleep. Your effort alone will become the obstruction in attaining inner silence. You can become a statue-like outwardly, but inner dialogue and disturbance will continue unabated. You will be like the one who is sitting on a volcano, ready to explode any moment. You look at the situation. Look at the situation of your spouse. Both of you are sitting, maintaining the silence, making an expression of lovingness, but both of you are sitting on a volcano. And any situation comes in, you are ready to explode any moment. The volcano explodes. Just a little small pebble is to be thrown in the silent lake of your appearance, and the disturbance begins. It happened once, Nanak was the guest at the house of a Muslim chief, Nawab. Nanak is beyond religion. He is not religious in the way that you understand the word. Instead, he is awakened. An awakened person is not religious. He is not confined to any outer religions. His religion is his religiousness. His awakening is his religiousness. His understanding is his religiousness. One, he is the one who has known. One who has known. Nanak is beyond religion. One who has known is not bound by the finiteness of caste, creed and religion. Knowing this, the chief invited Nanak for Friday Salat or prayer. Nanak agreed for prayer only on one condition. He said, I will certainly offer prayers if you are going to offer the prayers. The chief could not understand this condition. He was going to offer prayers anyways. And remember, all your prayers are rituals. Deep down, the thoughts are going on because you are going to this, you are doing this prayer simply to correct your spouse, your friend, who has fallen into the trap of a devil. So that thought remains at the background. Or you have attained, you have reached to a state of financial difficulties. You are praying, but your prayer is a ritual to offset that situation that you have fallen into. The chief could not understand this condition. He was going to offer prayers anyways, like a ritual. Without knowing what he says, you drive unconsciously. Without knowing, your steering moves automatically. It is like a mechanical move. In your rituals, your hands move automatically, without any effort, and then this movement, the ritualistic movement, does not disturb your inner pattern of thoughts. Thoughts continue to float on the inner sky, and outwardly you continue your ritualistic way of prayers. The chief only knew this way of prayers, not the way of none. Entire village gathered, Hindus and Muslims too gathered. Everyone wanted to know what Nanak is doing. Hindus lamented as they thought Nanak is going to be a Muslim. Muslims rejoiced that a man like Nanak has now got senses. This is what happens. I have heard that Mullah Nasruddin was asked a question. If suppose someone becomes a Muslim, what would you say? Certainly he got this sense now. He has become wise that he has embraced the religion of the Holy Prophet, the Islam, the only religion. And next day or some days after, a Muslim was converted to another religion. People ask Mullah, what do you call it? Certainly he has fallen into the trap of a devil. He forgot he is leaving the religion of Allah and going into the religion of the devil. This is our understanding. The act is same, conversion from one religion to the same. Conversion from Islam to Hinduism, and in conversion from Hinduism to Islam, But it all depends on your conditionings. Muslims rejoice that man like Nanak has got now senses. Hindus lamented they thought Nanak is going to be a Muslim. He has gone mad or what? We see things as we are. And fear remains the guiding force of all our thinking and approach to life. Nanak entered the mosque. Prayer began. Nanak stood behind the chief for the prayer. The chief was angry as Nanak remained standing. Somehow the prayer finished. How can you pray or fool a Nanak? And when you are full of anger, there can be no prayer. When you are full of thoughts, your prayer will be a ritual. When you are full of anger or thoughts that your spouse is not doing things properly, how can there be prayer? Your prayer may be a ritual. Like a ritual, you may continue your prayer. Nanak entered the mosque. Prayer began. Nanak stood behind the chief for the prayer. The chief was angry as Nanak just remained standing. Somehow the prayer finished. How can you pray or fool a Nanak? And when you are full of anger, there can be no prayer except a falseness. And ritual is the falseness of prayer. The chief was angry with Nanak and complained that he did not fulfill his promise of offering the prayers. At this, Nanak reminded the chief of the condition. The condition was Nanak will definitely offer prayers only if Nawab or the chief offered the prayers. At this, the chief responded, "Are you in your senses? Everybody knows that I offered the prayers. People are witness to my claim." Nanak replied, "Because people are witness to your rituals. People see that you are doing a ritualistic prayer. Your hands are moving left to right, right to left. You are bending down. But what is going on deep within? The anger continues like an undercurrent. People are witness to my claim." He replied. Nanak replied, "I am not concerned with your understanding or witness. I am concerned with all that is happening deep within. You were in fact buying horses in Kaaba. And your priest or the imam was busy cutting the crops in the field. Now tell me, how can I offer the prayers when you did not?" This surprised the chief and the imam. Imam means one behind whom you stand in prayer. He leads you into prayer. The headman, the priest. The most important and the prestigious horse of the chief had died. And the chief was filled with agony and he was wondering how to go to Kabul and buy another horse. "Does your priest who is leading you in your prayers know that what is going on within you? He himself is ritualistic. He continues to tell you to do this, do that. And you continue to do ritualistically all your prayers, movement of the hands, offering of the flowers or whatever way of your prayer. But deep down something continues like an undercurrent." So too it was going on deep. A thought pattern, he was completely absent from the prayer. And the chief was filled with agony because his most prestigious horses died. And he was wondering how to go to Kabul and buy another horse. And as far as Imam is concerned, his crop was ready. There was shortage of labor. This worried him and he was cutting the crop. "How can I offer prayers when neither you nor your priest offer prayers?" Prayer is a state of awareness. It springs out of your inner serenity. Prayer, meditation, etc. cannot be forced on anything. And neither prayer nor meditation is ritual. That you sit down with your closed eyes for 1 hour, tell everybody not to make noise, close up, but you are constantly, a phone rings, you are wondering who called. I wonder if that person called and what the person had called for. Maybe something important. That is what is going on while the ritualistically you are engaged in your prayer and meditation. It cannot be forced. It is not important what you do. It is not important that you are doing prayers or meditation or anything ritualistic. What is more important implies what is going on deep within you. You can be a statue-like. You can hold and discipline your body easily but not the mind. You can put on your special garb to do the prayers. You can sit down in a particular position, a statue like. All these things can be conditioned. All these things can be done very easily. But you cannot control the mind. What is going on within at that moment of rituals? And remember, the moment body becomes motionless, the mind becomes more active. Remember, the moment body becomes motionless, because there is an energy continuously moving through the body movements, but all of a sudden body has become still. Where that energy will go? This is why when people sit down in meditation, more and more thoughts arise, more and more they feel more disturbed, and they leave the meditation. This is what happens when people go into the meditation. More thoughts arise in the inner sky. You can hold and discipline your body, but not the mind. This is what happens when people go into meditation. More thoughts arise on the inner sky. Whenever you go into your religious place, your inner disturbance surfaces. So people feel more bored when they go to the temple and the churches and down your so-called place of religions. When you are engaged in work, there is not much energy remain for disturbance, because your hands are constantly moving. You are in work always. There is no extra energy. And when you sit in meditation or prayer, your energies are not divided. There is a total energy available and disturbances surfaces. So all that energy is going into your disturbance. When you are in a theater or a discotheque, you remain peaceful. You can remain waking all night. However, when you are in meditation or prayer, or when you are in that kind of environment, you remain twisting and turning, disturbed. Why does this happen? Theater, discotheques are all associated with your desires. There, all that is being provoked, which is part of your deep unconsciousness, this resonates with you. Hence there is enjoyment. You enjoy something that resonates with you. Meditation is not part of your unconsciousness. It surfaces your unconsciousness. It does not resonate with you. That's why you don't like meditation. All that goes on in discotheque associates with your desire. There all that is being provoked, which is part of your deep unconsciousness, is resonates with you. Hence there is enjoyment and you are never bored. Whatever happens in temple does not resonate with you. Whatever happens in meditation does not resonate with you. This is why such things remain boring. Nanak says, even by plasticizing silence you cannot attain. You may continue to meditate, but nothing will happen. The hunger of the senses will not vanish even if the mountains of food is provided for. Does food satiate you? Never. Has it satiated you? You will not feel hungry again. But once you have tasted the food of meditation, all the satiation comes. The hunger vanishes. The hunger for God is not ordinary hunger. Nothing can satisfy this. How can we be truthful? And how can this veil of ignorance and falsehood be removed? Nanak says, hukum is the only way, the existential law. This is the very significant state. Hukum rajai chalna, Nanak likhiya na. What is hukum? Literally, it means the order or command. Nothing will happen by your doing. When you are false, all that evolves will definitely be false as well. It matters not if you are speaking truth. To Nanak, hukum implies the cosmic law, the synergistic harmony. Before I explain this, an anecdote. Once Nanak stayed in a village. The chief of the village had a religious function. Entire village was invited. Nanak was also invited, but he did not go. Instead, he stayed at the place of a poor carpenter, Lalu. Several times the chief sent a message for Nanak, but he did not go. Ultimately, the chief came himself. At his request, Nanak accompanied him to his place. However, Nanak refused the pure sanctified food. The food was prepared by the chefs who took bath with the holy waters before starting the cooking. At this, Nanak said, "Now that you insist, bring your food and ask Lalu to bring his dry roti or the flat bread without any vegetables too." It is said Nanak took the dry food of Lalu in one hand and another hand he took the delicious food of the chief and squeezed. It is said from Lalu's food the streams of milk came out, whereas from the food of the chief blood came out. This is symbolic. I do not know if it happened this way or not. It is significant for me. If you are dishonest, it does not matter if you bathe or wash the vegetables in pure and holy water. If you are full of conditioning, hatred, anger, jealousy, it does not matter whether you take a bath to make tea, then every grain of your food is soaked in blood. It is not important if this really happened or not. However, the anecdote is very significant and gives an important message. Nanak says nothing will happen on your own. When you are dishonest, when you are full of anger, enmity, jealousy, this will become part of you. You will speak truth only if it benefits your dishonesty. Even your truth will harm others. Nanak says, leave everything to him. Let thy will prevail. Whatever condition or state he keeps you, remain pleased and blissful. His contentment or way becomes your way. Accept all that is happening. Flow with life. Life is given by God. Only He knows what is good and what is not. Be in harmony. Behind every happening there is a cosmic law, a meaning, a secret. Thy wish is my command. Then you will find that suddenly an inner harmony, oneness and silence begins to descend. No more worries. You are part of this cosmic harmony. What is the worry? The worry is that you are not in harmony with all that is happening. The only sutra of peace in the East from Lao Tse to Nanak is total acceptable. Umar Khayyam says moving finger writes and having writ moves on. Nanak says hukum rajai chalana Nanak likhyana. There is a law, the cosmic law. Everything happens according to this cosmic law. Flow with this cosmic law. You can float in the sky that Nanak calls Ek Omkar Satnam. Ek Omkar Satnam is the sky where you can float. And there is only one methodology, the hukum, the wish of God. Once it happened in bulk, there was a chief called Ibrahim. He had a slave who was very vibrant and loving. Ibrahim brought him home. Because of his ways and means, he fell in love with the slave. Ibrahim inquired how he wants to remain. What would he like to eat? It is said the reply of the slave was beautiful. The slave said, "My wish does not matter. Whatever the master wants really matters. I am your slave and you are my master." It is said with this reply, Ibrahim's life transformed. He bowed down to the slave. Ibrahim got the secret that he had been searching for so long. This is hukum rajai charna Nanak likhyana. This is Nanak's methodology to attain to inner oneness, harmony and bliss. Thus Nanak blocked all doors for ego. First Nanak emphasized the Guru Kripa or Parsad, and now he gave another one, hukum rajai charna Nanak likhyana. Be within the existential law. Flow with the ultimate will. He alone knows what is right. This is the way of surrender. Ek Omkar Satnam. Only this much.